The water rushed all around us, sea spray spewing up against our skin, and wind rushing through our hair. On the shores of the Sleeping Bear Dunes, we had revisited old memories. But now, it was time to find new adventures and experience new places on North Manitou Island.
Disembarked and took in all the sights and smells around us. The waves churned against the sandy shores, and the flowers and grass swayed in the wind. We had just landed on the island, but we already liked what we saw. It was time to go exploring.
We made our way to the ranger station, where we were greeted by beautiful birch trees and some friendly rose chafer beetles. There was a quick orientation for everybody getting off the ferry, where a ranger went over the basic rules and safety tips. And inside the old ranger station were some barn swallows and a 3D map of the island.
On this trip, we'd be hiking south until we found a good camping spot. From there, we'd explore various other places on the island without our full packs.
Already, the island was stunning. Bright green grass and deep blue water. This was a dreamlike landscape.
It's funny because we've gone to so many different places, and every time I see something that just blows me away, and I think I can never see something any more amazing than this. And yet we continually see things that continually blow my mind. And it's different from everything else we've done, but at the same time, it's the same, because it gives me that same feeling of joy and openness and nature.
It was strange. Even though there were abandoned houses and a paved path, which the Park Service preserved for historical and cultural reasons, this place felt wild. We'd never felt more like we were embarking on a great journey of some sort. The tall trees and the garden-esque hedges and flowers felt like the remnants of an ancient, mythical garden. The paved path gave way to dirt as it entered the forest. Like the entrance to some mysterious, fantastical realm, the woods swallowed us up.
There was a downed log blocking the path, which a ranger had warned us about. But it wasn't hard to bypass.
Soon we entered a grassy opening in the forest. The swaying of the grass and the dancing of the light gave us a feeling that we were underwater, deep beneath an ocean of green leaves.
The trail transitioned from forest to field, and there was a small side trail that led us back towards the deep blue seashore.
We literally hiked maybe, how far is that, Brian?
25, 50 feet. just off the trail to the left.
We've only been on the trail for a short while and we went through some amazing grassy areas and forested areas.
Yeah, and the bugs have been good so far, so.
Bugs have been great, like no mosquito problems whatsoever. If we had listened to what people said, we would have missed out on some of the most amazing stuff we've ever seen.
Yeah, if we had listened to ourselves while we were hiking out of that forest, we'd probably, because I don't know, that whole time it was wet and rainy and we were getting bitten and it was so tempting to just leave or something.
It's really easy, you know, when bad situations just kind of come together, like mosquitoes and weather and things like that, it's really easy to get discouraged, but you know, it's things like this that make it completely worth it. Walking down this beach and found this rock here that has fossilized coral in it. You can see the crystallized layers of coral inside of it. Just thought it was a pretty neat find.
And that wasn't all we found.
So all around this brushy area by the beach are these juniper bushes. And I don't see any berries right now, but potentially you could pick some juniper berries and use those to flavor your food. I'm also noticing some mullein, which again is really good toilet paper because it's fuzzy and soft. And I'm also noticing a bunch of wild strawberry leaves. So I actually found a little strawberry growing here. It's still very young and delicate looking. And I'm super tempted to eat it, but this is the only one I found. And a good rule of thumb if you're foraging for wild foods is to wait until you found several of the thing you want to eat before picking any. That way you know that there's multiple plants with fruits and there's enough left for the rest of the ecosystem.
After looking for a few minutes, we found a lot more. It was time to chow down.
There's two types of wild strawberry plants. One has a yellow flower, one has a white flower. And the ones with a white flower are usually much better tasting. These look like real strawberries actually, but we'll give it a go and see how they are. Wow. Oh, shh.
Thank you.
That is incredible.
How's it? Mmm. Tastes like a strawberry.
Strawberry jam or something.
Wow.
It's a lot of flavor packed in that.
That's the first piece of fruit I've had in 6 months. Man, that's good.
Incredible.
They really were incredibly sweet.
It was back to the forest. The trail took us next to an area with a stand of young saplings. We suspect this new growth stood where a farm or orchard once was.
There's this incredible tree, this very old, mighty oak tree in the middle of all these, what looks like cherries or birches. And I'm about to go climb it. If you know anything about us, you know we like climbing trees. And I have a feeling I'm gonna feel very much like an elf when I'm up there. And it's interesting how a lot of the appeal of nature at first is filling out these roles and playing these roles that you always grew up with. You know, the role of the hero in a fantasy tale or something of that sort. Or the rugged adventurer in tales of colonists and Indians and things of that sort. But also in nature is where you learn to find yourself, where you learn to develop your own character and your own role. Anyway, time to climb. This is just incredible being up here. And I've actually found some oyster mushrooms, I think, growing out of the branches here. And the leaves look incredible with the sunlight.
We all climbed up to experience the beauty of the tree.
Wow, dude. Wow, that is beyond incredible. I feel like you're on a little treehouse or something.
Now this is a really incredible find. Oyster mushrooms. You can tell they're oyster mushrooms because the gills go down all the way to the stem. And they've got this distinctive white color with this very beautiful sort of oyster shape just coming out of that trunk. And to be sure, you probably want to do a spore print test where you leave it on something for a while. And if the spores are white, then that's a positive ID. But you can take these and cook it up and eat them. It's just amazing to see them living up on this old oak. And when I climb this, I can't help but wonder
what this tree has seen, and I can't help but get the sense that this tree is a very nurturing mother to the rest of the forest.
Back on the ground, we saw a curled up millipede, and some non-native honesty plants with their coin-shaped seed pods.
The trail once again went from forest to field. All of the scenery around us was absolutely breathtaking.
And here, we found another sweet treat growing around us.
We found this incredible big bunch of sorrels, and hopefully it does not beckon in the rain and the mosquitoes like it did at the White Pine Trailhead. This tastes incredible.
The big ones and the small ones, it tastes about the same.
Yeah, they're just like really tangy apple peels.
Better leave some for the cows.
Through an incredible meadow and followed the path to a dark forest.
Actually, turn around. I think we are gonna give up for now and just go to that clearing to stay there because that was way too good of a spot.
Okay.
Yeah, so, I agree.
We'll have a lot of good stars and we can always explore this trail later when we take our packs off. This is a really beautiful forest, but most of the places we've stayed in have been forests, and I am ready for that big meadow. Hearing the crickets and just smelling the air gives me a huge sense of nostalgia.
We couldn't believe how beautiful the meadow was, and we were excited to sleep out here beneath the stars.
So we've come back to this field to camp, and it's such a beautiful spot, but there aren't too many good trees where I can sit up. I do see a single sapling over there, so I'm gonna try to find a hiking stick type thing so I can use that to hoist my tarp up.
I got really lucky with a dead standing sapling.
This might be a lucky find. Looks like a dead branch and still sort of stuck in the ground, but I can break it up and probably used it as a good thing to hang my tarp up. Yeah, this should do well.
I carved a stake, making sure it was long enough to remain sturdy in the sandy soil.
There is a wood ant's nest not too far from my tarp. Luckily, when you use a tree, you can rotate the tarp in any orientation you want, so you're not restricted to where your trees are. And honestly, I will take ants over mosquitoes any day. I am sleeping in this beautiful tarp tonight. Unless there's mosquitoes.
And then it was time to set up the tents.
After you've done it several times before, setting up tents becomes a relaxing ritual at the end of the day.
It felt good to take our boots off and rest our feet. This was still the same day we had experienced all the rain and mosquitoes back on the mainland, after all.
It was time to cook. And since fires are prohibited here, we once again used the Supercat stove to cook our meal.
I prepped some rice and had a snack while I waited for it to boil.
Dried fruits like this dried mango are lightweight, delicious, and have a lot of calories in them too, so it's good for hiking.
Another one of these strange Chinese canned seafoods I got is this eel, which has a black pepper on it. I think I might put a little garnish on there. And instantly it looks like a gourmet meal. See how it is. The great thing about these is that you can just eat the bones straight.
This right here is clarified butter, better known as ghee, and it can be stored at room temperature for up to 6 months. So this is actually good camping food.
Clarified butter contains no milk solids, so it's great if you're lactose intolerant.
Decided to go a little Asian with the rice and put a little sweet and spicy sauce on there to kind of mix it up and give it a little more flavor. So hopefully that tastes good.
It did.
I finally got around to removing this rubber handle that was on this lid and I replaced it with a nice metal keychain ring. I don't know, that was a huge design flaw overlook, but now my handle won't melt when I'm cooking stuff and I can just slide a stick in here to lift the lid off. I've made some rice porridge, or otherwise known as congee. And it's pretty bland, but I'm gonna add this pork wool, which is a pretty common thing you see people doing. The traditional way to eat this is with a lot of small little dishes. So I've got another can of roast eel here. And I've got this, which is a very peculiar thing. It's a preserved duck egg, also known as a thousand-year egg. And it's just this egg that they've preserved in a lye solution. And the weird thing about it is that it's black, like obsidian. Now, it's pretty strong to eat, so I'll be adding soy sauce to this and eating it with the rice, which will help neutralize that preservative taste.
We were really full from dinner and quite tired, so we drifted off peacefully to the sounds of whippoorwills.
It was an incredibly beautiful night, even though it was cloudy. Although I did get up at one point and I saw some stars, which was nice. I cannot tell you how wonderful it was to finally sleep in the open air, to feel all the breezes coming by. I did have to give in at one point and just use DEET. The mosquitoes weren't that bad, but I just used bug spray because I was writing in my journal and they were bothering me. And after that, there were pretty much no mosquitoes at all. So it was really nice. And to wake up to the sound of the crickets and the bright sun in this big field, it's great. The shirt is still wet after several days, so I'm gonna finally dry it off in the sun. And I'm gonna use a stick. You need one that's not completely dry. And I'm just gonna very carefully split it slightly. You gotta be really careful that you don't cut yourself. Then you got yourself a little bushcraft clothespin.
Of course, if you're gonna seriously use this, you should tie a string around the stick where the split ends to make it tight and secure. Otherwise, the clips won't last very long. We packed up the tents and most of our gear and slid it under Andrew's tarp. We headed back onto the trail, hiking through beautiful woodland. At one point, the trail brought us to an incredible corridor of trees, whose branches arched overhead like the ceiling of a Gothic cathedral.
We were searching for some large clearings marked on our map that looked interesting, but we never ended up finding anything. Although it doesn't look like it, we had hiked for a long time. At least 8 miles total, and we're exhausted.
We decided to head back to the area where we had first come on shore to refill water and rest. On our way there, we passed through what seemed like an old cherry orchard. This red-spotted admiral butterfly joined us as we relaxed.
We saw the boat dropping off today's group of hikers. After some much-needed resting, we headed back on the trail, this time making our way to a small lake.
As we strolled through some beautiful meadows, we passed by the Frank Farm apple orchard, an old farm that belonged to a past inhabitant.
We again found ourselves wandering back into the woods. The shade gave us a nice bit of respite from the heat.
There's these beautiful jack-in-the-pulpit flowers here, which are native to the area, but I have never in my life seen one that is this big. This is just a monstrosity of a jack-in-the-pulpit. Pretty incredible. All along the forest trail, we keep running into these random granite boulders just placed along the foliage. And these are actually glacial erratics, which are rocks that were left behind by the glaciers about 10,000 years ago. And this is not the sort of rock you'd find naturally forming here, so we know that it's something that was left behind by the ice sheets.
It's quite a bit of wind right now, and it looks a little cloudy, so there's a possibility for rain. It also feels like the sun's still out, though.
Yeah. But hopefully, there won't be any rain.
Because we definitely left our poncho gear at the campsite to try and cut down on weight.
Not a good idea.
Could be a mistake.
It was pretty silly on our part to not bring the ponchos. They're light and compact, so there's really no reason not to always have them with you.
But at least these common garter snakes didn't seem too worried about the weather. Even if snakes make you squeamish, there's no need to worry. These common serpents are friendly, calm, and have a harmless bite. If you do scare one, it will likely just spray smelly pee on you as a defense mechanism.
We just hiked 1 mile, according to the map. The previous signpost to this signpost was 1 mile. And we've been timing to see how long it takes to travel a mile so that we can actually know how far we are and how close we are. And we've actually gotten pretty accurate. It's just about 23 minutes for every mile. And we've always gone by the rule of thumb that it's about 3 miles per hour for walking, so that's actually pretty accurate.
We pushed a bit through the forest and eventually saw the bright water of the lake through the trees. Finally, we had made it.
And of course, you don't come to a lake on an island in the middle of another lake to look at it. We eased our way in and adjusted to the temperature, which was actually surprisingly mild. The floor of the lake was soft and sandy too, which made it even more pleasant.
Feels great to wash up in some fresh water after a long day's hike. Water allowed us to goof off and relax.
But there are some dangers hidden beneath.
Oh, whoa. They have to be really careful. Touching shows, paying shows, especially walking shows. And when you want more, you're trying to grab me. Ah! You won't grab me! You're just going to grab you! Stay home and break your neck! And see here, the body just fled.
Someone had left an inner tube by the shore. I usually hate littering, but this was really fun to use.
I'm off of the Rock Candy Mountains!
I don't know whose chair this is. It's pretty fantastic. And I bet they're pretty sad that they left it here. We'll get to the other side eventually. We'll take a piña colada. Salt on the rim, please. I'll just come back when you're done.
The water had been surprisingly warm, especially considering how frigid Lake Michigan felt. It was great to swim in.
And I really needed a bath, so that's good too.
We had had our fun, and it was time to dry off. Some stratus and alto stratus clouds seemed to be moving in, and we didn't want to get caught in the rain.
On the hike out, we found some interesting treats.
So I've seen lots of beautiful plants in this area. Trilliums, bloodroots, and of course, edible violets and burdock. But one edible plant that you might not notice this time of year is this, which is the remnants of what's called ramsins or ramps. And it's also known as wild garlic or wild leeks. But if you dig underneath, you'll see this beautiful garlicky bulb here that you can pluck up. And that will give you a very tasty garlicky treat.
We again stopped at the village before heading off again.
As payment for the beauty and the resources that Mother Nature provides, throwing away all this litter that I found on the trail. And conveniently, they've got some garbage cans in this area, so I'm just gonna go do that.
Thankfully, there wasn't too much litter, but I wanted to clean up any that I saw, especially since I took the garlic bulb. It's always important to think like a conservationist when foraging.
So there is this beautiful birch tree with all these oyster mushrooms growing on it. They've got this very pure white color. The gills are going all the way down to the stem, and the stem is sort of non-symmetrical. And there's so many that I think it's worth it to collect a few and cook them up later. So let's get to work.
It's best to store mushrooms in a paper bag so they stay dry and don't build up moisture. But this is all we had. Plus, the plastic allowed us to see the spores of the collected mushrooms. When we saw that they were white, we knew for sure we had picked the right fungi.
Very beautiful.
Don't worry, we left plenty behind for continued spore production, and for the beetles and slugs chewing on the caps there.
The slugs were also eating this edible crown-tipped coral fungus, and they didn't leave much left for us.
Back at the camp, it was time to prepare the mushrooms for supper.
We first cut the oysters into our cooking pot, gave them a quick rinse, and lit the stove. Next, we added some of the clarified butter, letting it melt down. Add to that, some crushed red pepper and some sorrels. Now it's time to add this beautiful garlic bulb here. I'm gonna cut this a little bit off.
I need to be stirred. Give me that spoon.
I
really reaching up. The aromas were already incredible. Oyster mushrooms, sorrels, and wild garlic. And stirred with a wooden spoon on top of that, this is truly a woodsman's dinner. The butter boiled and bubbled. We couldn't wait.
First, a taste test.
Tastes like buttery mushrooms, which is good.
Then, to make the meal presentable.
Need a little garnish.
Finally, to the eating.
Let's do it.
Now, we await the judge's verdict on Iron Chef Morimoto's dish.
Wow.
It looks like a Chinese dish, and it tastes like a Chinese dish.
Mm-hmm. Very good, eh?
Doesn't that taste like a Chinese dish?
It does, yeah. I wonder if the sorrels are adding a slight sweetness.
This might be that garlic a little bit.
Yeah, I want to try this.
Well, this is going to be a sweet bite. Yeah, I'll save that mushroom.
There's a really strong garlic. Well, no, it isn't, but flavor must have been sucked out. Got some sorrel in this one.
Wow, this is mother excellent. Oh, I can't say that on camera.
Wow, when this tastes better than the food that I eat every day, I really gotta start getting more creative with my cooking.
All right, are you done?
Yeah.
Okay.
Job well done. Good job.
Oh!
Take this little scrap right there.
Later in the evening, we sat around to reflect on our trip so far.
It's funny how we've only been on this island for just one day, really, in terms of hours. And it feels like we've been here forever at the same time. The sort of relaxation we have right now is like such a stark contrast to the struggle we felt on the mainland.
Yeah.
When we were hiking out.
You guys have been like, let's give up. I've been like, cool, I'm ready to go. But it's weird because your fortunes can turn so quickly in nature. Just like in real life, I suppose,
yeah.
Too. Well, that's funny too, because remember there was those people talking to, or when we were at the campsite, there was those two people talking about, they were warning people about the black flies. Mm. And then people would just go anyways, not heeding their warning. But sometimes if you heed the warning, then you would miss out on things. Because if we had heeded people's warnings about the mosquitoes saying it was even worse here, we would have missed it. So sometimes you just don't know how it's going to be. Yeah.
That's what camping is all about. It's all about learning from the experience. That's the bottom line of all my camping experiences. And learning from it. Like, when we went winter camping, I was like, okay, gotta get a better sleeping bag. You know, the first camping experience, gotta buy a better tent. You know,
better backpacks.
Gotta buy a sleeping mat, you know, things like better backpacks for, you know, support. And, you know, now when we go camping, it's just so enjoyable because, you know, I've learned so much.
Tomorrow morning, we gotta go out to that ferry. Yep. Head back.
Have a good night, guys. Good night, gentlemen.
This night hadn't been quite as peaceful as the last. It started storming pretty heavily. At least we were all in our shelters by then.
It's really, really windy. My brother's still out there under the tarp.
Bryan and Robby keep asking if I'm gonna be able to make it in here.
But I've cleared some space in my tent in case he needs to jump in.
It is holding up quite well.
Hopefully it doesn't come to that. Hopefully the wind dies down soon and the storm passes pretty quickly.
Oh.
He's in that little tarp right there. Toughing it out. Not sure if he's wet or not, though.
Well, that was a very strong gust. I feel like the tarp is swallowing me whole. I feel like I'm on a small canoe in the middle of a large stormy ocean. The tent stakes are actually holding up surprisingly well. Unfortunately, I can't show you too much, but these things are just like sails and the wind will blow them this way and that. I think the biggest thing I'm worried about is actually this stick over here, but that's holding up well as well. I've got some of my stuff packed in the bag just in case I need to make a quick move, but we'll see. I think I'm gonna be alright. I mean, people sleep in tarps in blustery weather all the time, right? maybe. Okay, you can see how it's whipping back and forth. Like Willow Smith's hair.
The dewdrops glistened like diamonds, refracting the first touch of the early morning's light. Crickets chirped below the grass, and birds sang from above the treetops. We heard a scalp flying overhead, across the open blue sky. If there's a heaven, we were sure this is how it felt. And we wanted to stay here for eternity. But we knew our journey was coming to a close.
We weren't saddened by this, though. Hard as it may sometimes seem, a life lived in the present, neither clinging to the good parts in life, nor resisting the bad parts, allows one to be truly free and able to taste every bit of life.
We were back at the docks. It had been an incredible journey, from the familiar, nostalgic sand dunes of the mainland to the fields and lakes of North Manitou Island. As we watched the waves gently rolling in and felt the sun's warm light fall against our skin, we reflected on the time that had passed.
All of the people we've met and the people we've lost, all the people we've loved, all the people we've hurt, we thought about how much we'd grown. How much had changed. All the stories we've had. On the wild shores of the island, nature seems to bring comfort to our souls. It forgives us for our mistakes, brings comfort where we are restless, faith where we are anxious, and love where we lack it.
But the wilderness is not the only place where adventures happen. It is a lens through which we regain perspective, and learn to appreciate all of the adventures that make up our daily lives.
The misty clouds swirled away, dissipating to reveal the sun and the blue sky. They melted like sand through our fingers or time through the years. Oftentimes, we look longingly at the past, wishing to return to better days. But the crashing waves and the shining sun remind us to stay in the present, to cherish what we have right now, and to do our best to bring that joy to others. It is difficult to let go of the past, and to see things that we adore and are familiar with disappear. But perhaps, like the clouds, the past melts away to reveal a brighter, sunnier future.
Thank you.
You want to try some squid?